Welcome to Postscript. Here we hope to answer your questions and help you dig deeper into the messages and sermons at Faithbridge by talking with the teacher of the day.
Hi, and welcome to Postscript. I'm Dan Slagle, and today I am with Michael Sully Sullivan, who brought us a terrific message on friendship, taking an inventory of the friendship that existed between King David and Jonathan. Welcome, Sully.
Thanks for having me.
It was a great message.
Thanks.
I really appreciated the different aspects of friendship that were brought to bear. Mm-hmm. I want to talk to you about some aspects of friendship in general that are reflected in Jonathan and David that perhaps time just did not allow for you to get to. And, and one of those is what we were talking about earlier, the seasonal component of friendship, how as we move through life, we don't necessarily keep the same sets of friends, and that's okay.
You know, some people are very fortunate, and maybe they grow up in a small town, and their best friend from kindergarten is there, and they never leave the town, and they're there their whole lives, and they get to share that relationship. But for most of us, my experience, your experience has been you move around. You know, you grow up in one town, you go to college somewhere else, you get your first job somewhere, you know, you move throughout life. And what I thought was so interesting about David and Jonathan's relationship is that this is the case for them. They were friends before David became king, and actually right before David officially takes the position, Jonathan dies in battle. And so they really were friends in this, scholars would say, probably 15-year period between Goliath and him actually taking the kingship. And it was really a difficult season of David's life. Most of, from chapter 17 of 1 Samuel, when David slays Goliath, to him actually becoming king, is running from Saul, fearful for his life. And Jonathan was there for him in that season. And he was not by his side when he was king. But God provided a man that we talked about a little bit last week named Nathan. And so in different seasons of David's life, he provided a friend. And I think from my experience, the temptation is to live kind of reminiscing of those old friendships. You know, when you have, especially from my friends at college, man, we were so close because we were all taking, had the same schedules. We were all taking the same classes. We were all working together. I mean, we were doing, we lived together. We were doing life together. And then you get into the business world and you can't spend every single hour of every day with them. And relationships change and new relationships form. So I think the temptation is to try and just keep those friendships only when you need people in your current context. You know, I think about what I was talking about today, who's going to move towards you in a moment of crisis. Here recently we've had floods, and you need some friends around you here in Houston that can come, like the testimony story we saw, come to your rescue and get you out of the boat. If your only friend is in Dallas, you're going to be waiting on the side of the road for a long time. So I just think that that is a, it's a component of friendship that a lot of people struggle to move along, but God provides in different seasons of our life the friend that we need in that moment.
Yes, He does. One thing I've always appreciated about my parents, they're 91 now, living in their hometown. The reality is their friends have all gone to heaven. But they have been very purposeful all throughout their life of making new sets of friends. And now they have an entirely different community of people much younger than they are that is a great blessing to them. Whereas if they didn't have those, life could be pretty tough. So friendships change, but the opportunity to make new friends is always there. Another thing we talked about was the noticeable difference in background between David and Jonathan, whereas Jonathan grew up in a palace and was accustomed to all the benefits and privileges of that. David grew up in the fields tending sheep, and then even as a young man had to live in caves running for his life. Talk some about the value of different backgrounds and friendships.
Yeah, it really is remarkable to think about just how different their upbringings were, but I think about how valuable it must have been for David to have a friend like Jonathan who could speak to, hey, this is what it's like in the palace. Here's the type of decisions you're one day going to have to make as king. Not only that, I think about what a value it must have been to David as a father to sit there and learn from the son of a king of, these are the things maybe I wish my dad would have done differently. I just think there's a lot of value when you have a diverse background of friends. If all of your friends are like you, then your worldview is strictly related to what you've experienced.
Yeah.
But, you know, kind of what you were talking about with your parents, having friends of different ages gives a different lens because you grow up in different generations. Mm-hmm. I was talking to Jill and just remarking how many of our friends are at different stages of life that have kids and are parenting. But I love that because we're getting a lens of what hopefully our future will be. And just there's an opportunity to share and to expand your worldview that I think is very helpful. So if you look around and say, oh, all of my friends look exactly like me, it might be time to expand that out a little bit.
So. I agree. My travels overseas have really highlighted this truth for me.
Sure.
I've made some wonderful friends from some cultures that I never dreamed I would be a part of or get to know, and they have added so much to my life.
Yeah.
I'm very appreciative for those different backgrounds. Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of Jill, I'm sure there are any number of viewers who would love to hear the rest of the story. I mean, of course, you got married, but in that particular instance, how did you wrap that one up?
Sure. Well, hats off to Wayne Risher, our Woodlands campus pastor, who talked me off the ledge. In fact, it was funny when I texted him, his first response was to send me a picture of a couple who was kissing with a big red X through it. And got me laughing pretty quickly. I was devastated. I'm like, I can't believe he sent me that. But it was a funny moment that, if you know Wayne, that was really just what I needed in the moment. But, you know, he talked me off the ledge, and Jill flew from Houston to Atlanta. So I remember when she got to Atlanta, she called me. And luckily, I'd already talked to Wayne because I don't know what I would have said first time.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was a sweet conversation. And in it, what I learned is that, and I did not know this about Jill up until this moment, was that she had never been kissed before.
Oh.
And so that's why there was this moment of hesitation.
Sure.
She said, I wish I would have, but I'd never done that. And so she just hesitated in the moment. And, you know, what was really neat about that for me is I was like, this is a catch right here. You know, she has valued purity, you know, into her 20s, which is not the case for a lot of people.
That's right.
And if I could say anything to especially high school girls or middle school girls who are going through relationships, that was a very attractive thing to me. And that was the kind of girl that I wanted. And I think that, you know, being pure and maintaining that is of the utmost importance. And there will be guys out there who that is what's attractive. And that's the relationships that I think last. And so that was interesting. A lot of people have asked out in the atrium, you know, well, when did you have your first kiss? I told somebody, I said, I think my pride was able to be cleaned up in about a month, and I think we finally got to it about a month later. But I was pretty scared every time thinking about that moment going forward. And we eventually got there, and now we're married, so it's all good now.
It is all good. And we're so glad that both of you are a part of our community here and that you provide the friendship for us that you do. Good sermon, good message for all of us. Thanks.
Yeah.
And thanks for being with us. Hope you'll join us next time for Postscript.
Thanks for joining us for Postscript. Help us keep the podcast interactive by submitting your questions during the morning services. Learn more at faithbridge.org/postscript.